Welcome to this webinar on gene therapy in hemophilia. My name is Frank Lebeek, and I'm head of the Department of Hematology in the Erasmus MC University Medical Center Rotterdam in the Netherlands. And we also have a large hemophilia treatment center in which we have treated many patients with gene therapy and have seen the opportunities and the obstacles in gene therapy for hemophilia patients. And that is my topic of today. First of all, is gene therapy an opportunity for hemophilia? It is caused by a single gene defect and therefore suited for gene therapy. A slight increase of factor is already effective and changes the bleeding phenotype in individuals with hemophilia. It results, and that's the aim of the gene therapy, in a reduction of bleeding, reduction in joint damage, and no regular prophylaxis is needed anymore. It's easy to monitor whether gene therapy is effective using routine coagulation laboratory assays, and even small increases in expression of factor 8 and 9 can be easily measured. And a high expression in general is not harmful in patients with hemophilia. So the aim of hemophilia is actually to transform the bleeding phenotype of a patient with severe hemophilia to a bleeding phenotype of someone with a moderate or mild hemophilia. And as depicted here, you can see that the number of bleeds, for instance, the annual number of joint bleeds, is very high in those with severe hemophilia, but decreases in those with, let's say, factor 8 level of 10 to 15%. And that is actually what we try to achieve with gene therapy. So most studies that are currently performed for hemophilia gene therapy are using adeno-associated viruses. And especially AAV8 and AAV5 are most frequently used because they have a strong liver tropism. So they enter the liver, they enter the hepatocyte easily, and thereby deliver the gene of interest episomal in the nucleus of the hepatocyte. So in most of the studies that I'll present today, those two factors are used. The first successful gene therapy trial was performed in the UK in the University College of London in collaboration with the St. Jude's Hospital. And it showed for the first time that long-term safety and efficacy could be reached by gene therapy using an AAV8-based treatment. And wild-type factor 9 gene was inserted into AAV8 and infused, single infusion, in 1 hour to a patient intravenously. And these are some of the results of this study. This is 4 years after the initial treatment in patients treated in the highest dose of factor. And what you can clearly see in these patients, and that is depicted in yellow, is the factor 9 activity. For instance, this patient who had zero factor 9 before starting, being a severe hemophilia B patient, and he had factor 9 levels of 8%, and eventually over 2 years of about 5% factor 9, leading to a reduction in bleeding and also factor concentrate use. And similar patterns were seen in other patients, resulting in the general group to about 5 to 10% of factor 9 activity. So the expression of factor 9 was leading to a reduction in bleeding episodes and a factor 9 use, as is shown in this picture. Here are shown the bleeding episodes before and after gene transfer. Of course, these patients used prophylaxis, so they didn't have a very high bleeding episode rate, but it reduced dramatically after gene therapy. And the same holds for the factor use, from about more than 2,000 units per kilogram per year to less than 500. This was the first study, but since then, many other studies have followed. And currently, 43 hemophilia gene therapy studies are ongoing or have been performed based on clinicaltrials.gov data. And one of the studies that followed this initial study was a study that we also performed in our center and included patients, and that used also a wild-type factor 9 gene in an AAV5 factor. This was given to 5 patients in a low-dose cohort of factor and also in a higher-dose cohort. And the results after 2 years of treatment are that the low-dose cohort had a mean factor 9 activity of about 5% and a mean factor 9 activity of 7% in a higher-dose cohort. And what you can see, and that is very important, is that that expression is stable over a period of 2 years. An addition and an important change in factor 9 gene therapy was the use of a variant of factor 9 with a high specific activity, and that is the Padua variant. The Padua variant was described initially in a family with thrombosis, in which it was seen that they had high factor 9 levels due to a variant gene mutation in the factor 9 gene that resulted in high factor 9 levels and resulted in thrombosis. And using this variant with a high specific activity led to higher factor 9 activity levels after gene therapy, as is shown here. So the expression of the protein remains similar, but the specific activity of this variant makes higher activity levels, as shown here, between 15 and 50%, with a mean of 33%. And all currently ongoing studies with the factor 9 Padua variant are currently ongoing. This is a phase 2b study using the same factor that I just showed you from the study by Miesbach, also using this Padua variant with a high specific activity. And you can clearly see that the levels obtained in the earlier studies, about 7%, are now 5 to 8-fold higher in those treated with the Padua variant. So the data of the phase 3 study are eagerly awaited. And if we summarize the current studies, this has been done by Victor Aruda in a recent issue of the Mediterranean Journal of Hematological Diseases, you can clearly see that there is a clinical benefit from various studies in hemophilia B. Some of the studies, and these are the older studies using AAV2, were not successful, but since the introduction of the AAV5 and AAV8 factors by Nadwani and colleagues, all the other studies show high expression levels of factor 9, also with a follow-up up to 8 years now from the Nadwani study and 4 years from the Unicure study, and still showing a stable expression. So we can conclude that for hemophilia B patients, it is definitely an opportunity leading to sustained expression of factor 9, and also reduction of bleeding, no need for prophylaxis anymore, and a reducing of cost of expensive coagulation factor concentrates. So what about hemophilia A? Patients with hemophilia A had to wait a little because it was difficult to get the large factor 8 gene incorporated into an AAV vector. And by deleting the B domain, it was possible to incorporate the factor A gene into an AAV vector. And this was done by colleagues from BioMarin. And they presented their results about 3 years ago now. And what you can clearly see from in this slide taken from their article in New England Journal of Medicine is that the expression levels of factor 8 and the activity levels of factor 8 obtained in the highest dose cohort of their study, that they normalized factor 8 levels in these individuals, resulting in no bleedings and also no factor use in many of these patients. But you can also see that some of these patients reach levels above 200%, making them actually prone to thrombotic events. So this was a large variability that is seen in many of the factor VIII trials, for which the explanation is yet unknown. And if we summarize the factor VIII gene therapy studies that are currently in clinical development or have been performed, still many of the data that are presented are phase one and phase two trials. And you can see that not only BioMarin, the data that I just showed you, show promising results, but also other studies by Spark Therapeutics, Sangamo Therapeutics, and others show very nice results. So we await the data and the publishing, the publications of these phase one and phase two trials, and also await currently ongoing phase three trials. So in this slide, I have summarized some of the opportunities and obstacles of gene therapy in hemophilia. And on the left side, you can see the various outcomes and aspects of gene therapy. In the middle, the findings in favor of gene therapy, but also on the right-hand side, the remaining issues of gene therapy that have to be resolved, the obstacles. So the clinical benefit is clear. From what I've just shown you, it is clear that there's a reduction of bleeding and stopping of prophylaxis for many of the patients after a single infusion of an AAV factor containing the factor VIII or IX gene. But there's uncertainty about the long-term efficacy and also the safety. We don't have those data yet. The eligibility of patients is of concern to many of the patients that I speak to. Treatment for both hemophilia A and B is now available, at least in studies, but it's not available for some patients that, for instance, have AAV antibodies, which occur frequently in the general population and also in hemophilia patients, patients with liver disease, for children with hemophilia, and others with severe comorbidity. So those patients have been excluded from studies. And the question is whether they will be able to receive this after it has been registered. The expression levels is important outcome, of course. We look at those factor levels and look whether the levels are high enough to reduce bleeding. And indeed, as I showed, stopping prophylaxis was possible in many of the patients with severe hemophilia. But there is also, and that is an obstacle, might be an obstacle, a large variability in expression levels of factor VIII and IX. And in one of the last factor IX studies that was performed, or still ongoing, factor IX levels above 200% were reached, and even a thrombotic event occurred in one of those patients for which the patient had to be treated with anticoagulant treatment. And one of the obstacles is that the reason for this variability is not yet known, despite the fact that patients get a similar gene construct. So some of these have high levels and some of them have low levels. Also, the durability of response is an important issue. We see now that for factor IX, there's a stable expression in a Nadwani study for over 8 years. Also in the factor IX study of Unicure, 4 years after treatment, still those levels are stable. But there is also some reduction of factor VIII levels, as I will show you in the next slide. One of the problems with this reduction of expression will lead to questions about how long a patient will benefit from this treatment. And this discussion about durability became even more complex when we saw these data, which were presented earlier this year in the New England Journal of Medicine. And if you look to the levels that I've just also shown you, and then I show you the yellow bars, those were similar to the bars that I've shown you before. The high expression levels after 26 weeks, after 1 year, slight reduction compared to the levels of 26 weeks. And thereafter, after 3 years, there was a reduction to about 40% of the original achievement. And even after 4 years, those data have been recently presented at meetings, there is a reduction of 75% of the expression levels after 4 years. And that, of course, is worrisome, because this might mean that in a few years, the patient will not benefit from gene therapy anymore. The expression levels of factor 8 and factor 9 can be measured both by chromogenic assays and one-stage assays. And as is shown in this slide, which shows us data of gene therapy trials over a few years, measured with a chromogenic assay or a one-stage assay, show clearly different results. And the same is seen for factor 8, as is for factor 9, that the chromogenic assays have a lower result than the one-stage assays. This is over time, but it clearly shows us that the levels measured with one stage are much higher than with the chromogenic assays. And this is important because patients want to know the levels that they reach. And it's still unknown which assay, the one stage or the chromogenic assay, reflects the chromogenic or the hemostatic potential the best. So this is something that we have to solve also as an obstacle. There have been also failures of gene therapy in hemophilia. And these are four trials that we retrieved in a recent review that we've written. And we found four studies listed on clinicaltrials.gov that have been terminated or are not recruiting anymore, and of which data showed that patients had not the outcome that we expected. For instance, this trial of which an article was last week published in Blood or online. It shows us that only 1 out of 8 patients had sustained an expression of factor 9. In this case, it was the factor 9 Padua variant was used. But due to immunological responses in 7 out of 8 patients, there was only temporary expression and they lost expression over time. These data, and especially also of the other studies, are presented at international meetings on a poster, but are hardly presented in journals as full papers. So it's difficult for other researchers to get all the details of these studies. And that's also important, and therefore it's very good that this paper of the Baxalta trial was published recently in Blood, and we can learn from it, and also this will benefit the research and our patients. To continue with the opportunities and obstacles of gene therapy, there have been fears of antibodies against factor 8 and factor 9. But in all the studies reported so far, none of these have been reported. And patients, that is something that we have to study in the future, that patients with a history of inhibitors to factor 8 and factor 9 have been excluded from phase 1 and 3 trials. But it may also be an option for them to get gene therapy. And I know that some trials are being initiated currently. There's also some toxicity. And here I listed toxicity and immune response, and they're actually related to each other, because it is seen in about 30% of patients, in a minority of these patients, an immune response will occur. And this immune response will lead to liver function abnormalities, and especially in ALT elevation. And one of the problems is that once such an ALT elevation occurs due to an immune response, also the expression levels of factor 8 and factor 9 may be reduced. And in the first studies, and that was shown, for instance, by the Nadwani study, but also in other studies like the SPARK studies, that in most cases, this responded very well to corticosteroids, preventing decline of these factor levels, and the remaining expression still resulted in clinical benefit. But there are also patients who have longer lasting liver function abnormalities, and that is unexplained. These patients are being treated with corticosteroids, but do not always have an underlying immune response. So there must be other reasons why these patients develop liver toxicity. And this is an important issue, which I'll be sharing with you also in the next slides. The availability of gene therapy. Studies are now performed in various countries in Europe, the USA, and Asia. and are so far available only in centers that have study expertise with gene therapy. So that has to be extended to other centers once the gene therapy becomes available on the market. The costs of gene therapy may be significant. It may be, on the one hand, cost-effective, because if you have expression levels over 8 years of, let's say, for instance, for the factor 9 treated patients, you don't need prophylaxis anymore, so you will have savings of these expensive coagulation factor concentrates. But on the other hand, the high costs that are expected for one gene therapy infusion may be significant. Redosing, that's another issue. There's hardly any data available, but it's not possible, that's what we know, to treat patients with a similar AAV-based technology for the second time. So this is important because some of those patients, as I've shown you, may have limited durability of their factor 8 gene transfer. And here you can see an example of a patient with an immune response. This is a patient who underwent gene therapy with a factor 9 construct. He had a very nice rise of factor 9 levels. Then an immune response occurred, as you can see here. This is a specific assay for measuring the T-cell response. And you can see at the time that this response is the highest that there's a reduction of factor 9 activity, and that coincides with an increase of ALT in the patient's plasma. And this is treated with prednisone. You can see that the liver function normalizes, the factor 9 stabilizes, and the prednisone can be tapered and stopped. And after that, the patient still has beneficial effect of the gene therapy. So this is seen in about 30% of patients. But in most recent studies, and that is seen in, for instance, a study, the GAD8 study from Bayer, which was recently presented by Steve Pipe at the EHA meeting and the WFH meeting. And you can clearly see that in patients followed 32 weeks after gene therapy, that they sometimes have ALT elevations, as you can see here. And also after 26 weeks, these may occur, requiring the patient to take corticosteroids now for up to 30 weeks. And that is something that we still not understand, because that's not always related to an immune response. It is very important to know the reason for this liver toxicity. And this is exemplified by a recent publication, an editorial in Human Gene Therapy, which presented the data of three patients who died after taking part in a gene therapy trial for myotubular myopathy. These patients were treated with very high doses of AAV vector, which resulted eventually also in liver function abnormalities, but also in liver failure, of which these patients eventually died. And it's very important to know why this occurred and what was the cause of this liver failure. This is important also for our patients who will be treated with gene therapy for hemophilia. So my conclusion is that gene therapy is a great opportunity for hemophilia patients. A growing number of studies show high expression levels of factor 8 and factor 9 and results in a reduction of bleedings and a reduction of factor use. It also leads to stopping of prophylaxis, which is very beneficial and improves the quality of life of these patients. But all these studies that have been published recently also reveal obstacles and limitations. And these obstacles must be understood and resolved to make the next step to registration and marketing of gene therapy. And with that, I'd like to thank you for listening to this webinar.